What is currently happening programs, welcome to The Grid VR, where I'll be bringing you this week's news in virtual reality. It's Sunday the 26th of August 2018, and all I can say this week is, there's just no ray tracing. We've got NVIDIA's new 20 series GPUs, NVIDIA's new 20 series GPUs, NVIDIA's new 20 series GPUs, and much more. Today, I'm going to cover off the main events, provided they're NVIDIA related, to keep you in the loop. So stay locked, enjoy, and welcome to the GridVidia VR. NVIDIA announced their new Turing GPU architecture at SIGGRAPH last week and followed that at GamesCon in Germany this week, where they unveiled the new line of gamer-focused RTX 20 series graphics cards. But what's the deal for gamers, and what does this mean for VR? Well, first, let's get the specs. The RTX 2070, 2080 and 2080 Ti cards are all based on NVIDIA's new Turing architecture and contain next-gen power supplies, fans and vapor chambers for cool and quiet performance. The cards are designed to be overclocked, which means the MSI and Asus Strix variants should be good when they hit the shelves, and under load, a RTX 2080 Ti puts out 1/5 the noise of a GTX 1080 Ti. There will be a new SLI bridge, which will ship in September and bring 50 times the bandwidth of previous SLI iterations. And people who spent $50k on a Volta DGX system have now been obsoleted by a single Quadro RTX 8000 GPU. Nice. The new RTX moniker of the cards is there because they all support real-time ray tracing, which is a means of creating extremely realistic interactions between lights, shadows, reflections, and the environments that contain them. To get a better idea of what I'm talking about, here is the new Battlefield game with RTX on, with RTX off, and with it back on again. Also, this slide here. And you can check the description for a link to the keynote highlight with all this goodness and more. Now, I know I've previously said it's not always about the graphics, but in this case, it fucking is. NVIDIA claims it the holy grail of graphics, and yeah, I'd tend to agree with that one. The realism of lighting is in direct proportion to the realism of a game that is trying to be realistic. Ray tracing is a big deal, and doing that not in real time takes a phenomenal amount of processing power. So much so that to render a few seconds of high quality footage with ray tracing can take weeks or even months to render out with a standard PC. And these cards do that in real time thanks to dedicated hardware RT cores that handle the task. And what we're getting is a form of sparse ray tracing, so not technically all the rays. Performance wise, NVIDIA is quoting a 35 to 125% gain in 4K flat gaming, and flash this slide, showing these games running at 60 FPS plus at 4K HDR. The company have also had to create two new systems to measure the performance available when rendering next generation games with hybrid graphics, which they've called RTX Ops and Gigarays per second, claiming that the new Turing cards have 6x the RTX Ops of Pascal 10 series cards and 10x the Gigarays per second of Pascal cards. That doesn't mean shit to anyone right now except the speculators though, as those numbers don't refer to any performance outside of ray tracing. And as there's no previous generation of RTX Ops and Gigarays per second measurements to compare those numbers to, of course they're going to be higher. On the other hand, we do know that the new DLSS Deep Learning Super Sampling can deliver similar graphical results to traditional anti-aliasing, but with better performance results from hardware acceleration. DLSS has been seen in NVIDIA's Infiltrator demo and is included in the bench results for these six games, which is where NVIDIA is feeding us numbers from. The problem is, it could be that this iteration of the Infiltrator demo is optimized for both ray tracing and DLSS, and so giving us ideal condition benchmarks instead of real world benchmarks. And no one has any real world benchmarks yet, so real performance performance gains? Who knows? I'd expect somewhere in the realm of 30 to 50% gains at least to justify the price, maybe more. But the real gains here are going to be in the lighting and shadow realism, not so much in the frame rates, but we'll have to wait and see. Though, for flat gamers, 4K gaming is here en masse it seems. So cool, what does this all mean for VR? Well, it's no secret VR is process intensive, and so any performance gains at a similar price point are going to be a good thing. And outside of this new generation of GPU, GTX 1080 Ti's have started to go for as low as $600. Ray tracing can also help reduce development time when it comes to lighting, as it kind of does its own thing compared to the current fake lighting till you make it step-by-step approach we have today. And in this article from 2014, a team over at Light Transport Entertainment Research cited that by nature, ray tracing is extremely suitable for foveated rendering, and due to the unified way it produces high quality shadows and reflections, is a great fit for aiding in immersive VR experiences. More info on foveated rendering in this video here. Major studios are supporting ray tracing, as it is not only a fit for games, but a huge game changer for CGI work, and it's something we've seen in things like Pixar's Cars. So immersive VR narratives, which are generally a little lighter on a system, could take advantage of this tech in more meaningful ways, and a lot sooner. And while AMD is working on their own line of ray tracing equipped cards, with 92% of Oculus home users currently using an Nvidia card, developers can safely build experiences with ray tracing off the back of sheer Nvidia market share alone. And indeed, the team at Solfar Studios have gained access to Nvidia's new VRWorks SDK and implemented some of its features for their upcoming in-depth expansion, Paradise Lost, citing a very notable performance gain thanks to the software development kit's new technologies, including the Tensor Core's accelerated anti-aliasing and variable rate shading, which works in a similar way to, and can be directly tied to, foveated rendering, in that it applies more detail in parts of a scene that require it, while throwing less power at parts of a scene that have less perceptible detail. Among the VRWorks SDK's other features is multi-view rendering, which enables next-gen headsets that offer ultra-wide fields of view and canted displays, and the NVIDIAWorks Audio SDK, which creates a physically realistic acoustic image of a virtual environment in real time using a ray-traced audio solution, which follows the path of sound instead of light rays. In saying that, while ray-traced audio for VR is a thing, we don't actually have confirmation as yet that ray-traced lighting works with VR at all due to potential latency issues. And in this post from Nvidia, specifically about ray tracing and VR, it kind of dodges ray tracing altogether. On top of that, In-Death doesn't look like it will feature ray-traced lighting either, despite being developed with Nvidia's RTX 20 series card specific SDK. So what does that mean? Well, before you get the pitchforks out, all it means is that ray tracing isn't something that just gets added to games by default. Developers have to build ray tracing into their games, and it may be that it's just too early days to see that tech in VR right this minute. But I can't see a future where ray tracing isn't involved with VR in a more visual way. And in fact, the new Assetto Corsa will have ray tracing and VR support, so perhaps there is some early hope there. Two things are for sure, it's a great time to be a gamer, and all of this will be beneficial for VR in one way or another. So again, we'll have to wait and see. Then there's the Virtual Link cable, which I mentioned in this episode of the Grid VR, which is a collaborative connection standard from AMD, Nvidia, Oculus, Valve, and Microsoft. And it's specifically designed for connecting VR devices like a Vive or Rift to a graphics card using one single USB-C type connection, instead of the multiple HDMI and USB cables we deal with now. This would be ideal for something like a laptop setup in particular, and all of NVIDIA's new Turing GPUs will have this hardware connection. This is a good thing, but what concerns me is that the standard set forth by the USB Implementers Forum states that the max length of a USB 3.1 Gen 2 cable using a USB-C connector is only 2 meters long. This could be lengthened, but at a much higher cost of production due to the higher quality components required. And so, to me at least, it seems like VR extension cables of the future may not be as easy or as cheap to source as current USB 3 cable extensions. This is likely something that hasn't gone unconsidered by NVIDIA, Valve, or whoever's developing VR HMDs, but again, we'll have to wait and see. Pricing wise, the RTX 2080 and 2080 Ti Founders Edition cards will ship late September and will be priced at $800 and $1,200 respectively, which makes the 2080 $100 more expensive than the 1080 Ti at launch, and the 2080 Ti versus the Titan X, the same price actually. All the while, the more wallet-friendly RTX 2070 will spin at $600. Pricing-wise, if we're talking decent gains for VR, thanks to the VRWorks SDK and ray tracing support, that sounds about right. But therein lies the caveat. We don't have actual real-world benchmarks, and we don't know when visual ray tracing will be a thing for VR. So my advice, don't pre-order shit. Unless you plan on benchmarking the card yourself, or you just have to have the latest card because you have an all-consuming love for technology, which is respect. I'd really like to know what you think about all of this in the comments below, so hit me up and let's geek out there. And finally, this channel hit 15,000 subscribers this week, and I'd like to thank everyone here who helped spread the virus so far. I know in the grand scheme of YouTube things, that's a tiny ass number, but to me, that's one third the number of attendees at Burning Man. So let's burn a virtual effigy, as I say in the most humbling and grateful of ways possible. Thank you. And that's this week on The Grid VR. You can help support this channel by grabbing exclusive rewards on Patreon, and if you like this video, then crush that like button, have your say in the comments below, and hit the XO logo to subscribe if you wanna. I'll see you in the next one. Peace!